worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior, totally transcended, expert in all dimensions, knower of all worlds, unsurpassable trainer of those who can be trained, both teacher and guide of gods as well as of humans, blessed, exalted, awakened, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha. Perfectly formulated is this Buddha Dhamma, visible right here and now, immediately effective, timeless, inviting each and everyone to come and see for themselves, inspect, examine, and verify, leading each and everyone through progress towards perfection. Directly observable, experienceable, and realizable by each intelligence. Perfectly training is this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples. They're training the right way, the true way, the good way, the direct way. Therefore, to these eight kind of individuals, these four noble pairs deserve both gifts, self-sacrifice, offerings, hospitality, and reverence or salutation, the joint palms. Since this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples is an unsurpassable and indeed forever unsurpassed field of merit in this world, for this world, to honor, respect, support, uphold, and protect. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. Good morning. Another walk and talk on early Buddhist philosophy. And this time we will take up one of the core tenets, because it's always most easy and most convenient to start with the beginning first. So a basic tenet in early Buddhism is the verbal device, which is called the three universal characteristics. In Pali, ti-lakkhana, which can mean directly translated as the three signs. You can also call it the three universal characteristics or the three absolute properties. But the three characteristics, universal characteristics, I think capture the meaning best. Ti-lakkhana, what are they? They are first impermanence, Anicca, meaning not permanent, not lasting, directly translated. So why is that a universal characteristic? Because there's nothing in samsara whatsoever, whether past, present, or future, whether internal or external, whether material or mental, whether good or bad, that lasts even for a millisecond. That is observable, huh? You are observing a process of mental and material states now, and you are one such process of discrete passing mental and material states yourself. So Anicca, impermanence, is easy to see because it is immediately evident in almost all objects. Of course, those who change fast are most easy to see. Those who change slow, like growing trees and the mountains, they are more difficult to see. But actually, that's just the time frame and also the scale one is looking at. If one look at microscopic scale, then every atom that has a temperature that is higher than the absolute zero is vibrating. And therefore, even atoms or even mountains, they evaporate slowly because of these vibrations of the atoms and thereby leaving the surface of the mountain. So nothing is the same from one Planck moment to the next. This leads up naturally up to that the recognition, the certainty that nothing can be kept because it all changes. When it changes, then it means that it becomes otherwise than it was before. When it becomes otherwise than it was before, then whatever it was before, like before, the young body, the young spouse, the attractive object, the joy in the food, the joy in the money, whatever, it changes and becomes otherwise, then it becomes something else. And thereby, whatever it was, it is lost to the past. And one can never regain it. One can never, so to speak, recall the past and get it back into existence. When gone, then it's gone. It's like a in the forest. A whistle in the forest, it is there when it's there, and then it's gone. And so goes for everything else. This clearly then gives access to the recognition that if one clings to whatever was, that is passing out of existence, that is becoming otherwise than the thing one liked, and now becomes into something one dislike, then one feels sorrow. Actually, it's worse than that, because before one actually loses the object, because one is craving for it, then as soon as there's this like and craving for it, then panic arises over losing it, over the thought of losing it. Why does the mind have this thought of losing the object? Because it has tried it a billion, billion, billion times before to lose whatever it has fallen in love with. Whether persons or things or circumstances or situations or objects or phenomena of whatever kind, the mind has very realistically evaluated, this I will also lose. And then they start this vexillation, when will it occur? And this the mind cannot point out when it will occur. We cannot point out to ourselves in most cases when this body will die and when we will lose it. We cannot point out. And because of that, and because we like having this body and we dislike losing it, craving towards an object and away from an event, the event of death, the event of sickness, aging and death. This we dislike, huh? So there's this panic because mind knows it will occur whether we like it or not, of course. Huh? It's just a matter of cause and effect, and it's a function of or direct, inevitable, inescapable consequence of impermanence. So whatever is impermanent is also, ultimately speaking, suffering, dukkha, bad state, bad business, bad situation to be in, bad circumstances to exist in, dukkha, while sukha, happiness, is the opposite, good state. So from impermanence, this recognition of the absoluteness, the all-pervadingness of suffering, dukkha, becomes self-evident. And that's why they come in this order, because impermanence is easy to see, easy to observe, easy to reflect on. Dukkha is more difficult. Why so? Because everyone dislikes suffering, so they don't want to think about it. But covering up the truth don't make it go away. On the other hand, trying to escape it makes it even worse. One has to take this bull of suffering by the horns, so to speak, and subdue it by the Noble Eightfold Way. That's the only way. Hiding in the bush, I say, dukkha doesn't exist. Suffering doesn't exist. It's only the pessimistic Buddhist that says that. That won't help you at all, actually. That will even further cover up, conceal, hide, obstruct, and veil this absolute universal characteristic of suffering. So dukkha, suffering, is an inevitable, inescapable consequence of impermanence. But couldn't we repair impermanence? That's actually what one tries by insurance companies and plastic surgery and all kinds of medical tricks. I'm a doctor myself, so I know. I also try to repair on aging, sickness and death, and thereby suffering. But it's not possible, actually, in this way. Of course, many try, but it's a folly attempt, because it only inevitably causes more suffering, because one becomes disappointed that the trick doesn't work. Impermanence doesn't go away. Aging, sickness and death and change of one's body, of one's circumstances, of one's economy, of the moment to moment, it doesn't stop. We could try to analyze if we could stop it, what would it look like? What would, if we stop change? Yeah, that entails stopping time. So everything will be frozen. Like that, it will be like life in a deep freezer or in a cement block. It's difficult to see how this could be happiness. So it's not possible to repair this fact, universal characteristic fact and property of all samsaric existence, whether high or low, of this impermanence, because it's a consequence of time going, basically. This change happens because time proceeds. And this proceeding of time is not something that you can stop within samsara. This means that you have to go to a dimension or a mode of existence that has no temporal characteristics, that is outside of space and time, that is outside Einsteinian space-time. This dimension is called Nibbana, which actually means to go out of time, to go out of impermanence, to go out of space, to leave this dimension of an endless forest of wrong views, which we are trying to repair right here by considering the three universal characteristics, ti-lakkhana. So, we cannot repair it, this impermanence. This means also, we cannot repair we cannot repair suffering then. Well, then this leaves only one option, that's Nibbana, actually. Even becoming divine at the very highest level, level 31, they are still under the spell of impermanence. They still cannot trust, even though it's happy and peaceful in a very, very subtle way, excessively peaceful. They see universes come and go like we see days come and go, without being excited or agitated about it. So it's very, very peaceful. They stay in supreme equanimity, supreme serenity. Nevertheless, even at that level, they cannot trust that state. They will also fall from that state. So that's also bad business. Bad states, dukkha, even the highest divine states. Again, this points to the fact, which one has to come to respect, that there is only one way out of this conundrum of repetitive suffering, and that's to seek Nirvana. The path, the Noble Eightfold Way, starts right there, at that recognition. As long as one thinks there are shortcuts, I can find another way around impermanence and suffering. There is a way. I'll find it. By plastic surgery, or becoming a millionaire, or pop star, or getting a new lover, new job, new teacher, new meditation center, new meditation course. I just sent out invitation for a meditation course I'm arranging, where we indeed will teach a lot about these issues. Nevertheless, it is seen that there is no shortcut. Then one takes the path serious. One say, if it really is so in the absolute degree, then one offer this path, this way out, where one has to renunciate and to say no to many things one like and accept many things one dislike. For example, sitting on the meditation pillow for prolonged hours, listening to Dhamma talks and teachers which keeps presenting nasty facts in a way that is not really escapable. One tries to brush it off, but one cannot brush it off because it's so obvious that it's true. So obvious. So now we have a situation where all phenomena, internal, external, past, present, or future, all states, all situations, all forms of being, all objects, pleasant as unpleasant, liked or disliked, they are, ultimately speaking, suffering because they are impermanent. What about food, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, for example, and money? They cannot be suffering. No way. Well, it's true that these phenomena arise momentary happiness in mind, and therefore also a lot of clinging, because one wants to regain them when lost them, when have used the money, or have had the sexual intercourse, then one wants more and more and more and more, because of habituation. This means that it's a never-ending craving. It cannot be satisfied. Sensual desire cannot be satisfied. It's an endless pit that becomes deeper. The more sense pleasure you put into the pit, the deeper the craving becomes. However, one has to notice that a moment of pleasure, when the pleasure comes, then arise and cease, like any other moment, like any other phenomenon. When the pleasure arises, then it's agreeable. Also, when it's on the top point, it's also agreeable. But when the pleasure starts to go down, even though it's higher than before, then it's very disagreeable. So this means that any pleasure, momentary pleasure, is a catch-22. Because the more you like it, the more you become addicted to it, the more pain, frustration, and suffering you have to pay when it goes away. So, since it always goes away, then this pleasure seeking of momentary samsaric pleasures is a gigantic machine to create more suffering. Because these pleasures always go away, and one has to eat more. My 105-year-old dogs have come out here after me. Could it come hjem, fuldfisen? Nej, he could not come in, I closed the door. Så kom, så går vi hjem. Nevertheless, so is it. On the upshoot, the pleasure is agreeable, but going down, the pleasure is disagreeable. And because of habituation, addiction, clinging, then a large amount of sorrow, frustration, and suffering is felt when the pleasure goes away, and it always goes away. So cannot usually the hedonist view. The hedonist is, as we remember, one who claims that sense pleasure is the highest happiness, which is not the case actually, because jhana is the highest happiness here in samsara, and nibbana is the highest happiness outside samsara. So there's many happinesses that is higher than sense pleasure. So if one really wants happiness and pleasure, then one should seek something else than these banal, trivial sense pleasures that can be bought for money or can be looked at using porn, bad TV series, and what have you, of the usual sources of entertainment in the so-called modern world. The last aspect is more tricky, because if it is so, really so, that here the small stream comes, the centurion dog is following in his own tempo, slowly, steadily. My friend, we've been friends for 15 years, Mr. Judy and I. Come on, old man. Yes, yes, Bob, I'm coming. I'm coming, but now it's a stream. So, since it really is so that sense pleasure, seeking sense pleasure entails suffering because it's addictive, and since it really is so that everything is impermanent, we can come to the last characteristic, which is no self, which is the most difficult aspect to see. Here's a nice rock. We can also sit here. I think this is more easy. Oop. The last universal characteristic is no self. No self comes from the fact that if everything is impermanent, if the body is impermanent, if the feeling is impermanent, if the perception is impermanent, all experiences are impermanent, if mental constructions, hoping, intending, is impermanent, and if consciousness is impermanent, then nothing is the same, neither in here nor out there. If nothing is the same, then it cannot be a same self. It cannot be an identical identity. So this means I cannot be in a self. There's just this phenomena, these circumstances arising and ceasing and passing. There's nothing in there that's the same. It's neither the same nor is it another. It's a stream, it's a process, ever-changing process. It cannot be kept. You can put a name on it and call it something. Samahita or Einstein or whatever you like as a name, but that's only a label. Just like the label of a river is designating something that is always changing, always becoming otherwise, namely the water and the river. It's never the same. So also the stream of consciousness and the stream of physical characteristics and mental states, they also just a stream that is passing by. One cannot catch it and say it's the same, truly so. What one usually do is to identify with it, identify, and then to say, this whatever it is that is streaming, whether it's form, feeling, perception, mental construction or consciousness, this is me. Or one say, this I'm made of. Or one say, I'm inside this. Or one say, I'm the owner of this. But how can one be inside or own or be made out of something that is always changing, always coming and going? It never stays the same, it is always new. So this entails that there is no self, there is no same self, there is no identical identity anywhere to be found. When one gives up this idea of a self, then all pride, arrogance, and all the problems connected with pride and arrogance, they fall away completely, completely, completely. And this is a very pleasant, a lot of ease comes from that. The second argument is to see if things really are suffering, and if I'm experiencing pain and suffering, if there was a self, then this self would obviously be in control of itself. Then this self could make this painful feeling or this frustration or these circumstances and one dislike to make it into something else, make it into something likable, something pleasant. But no self can do that. No self can do that. It cannot create happiness for itself just by wanting it. And this means that the self is not in control of itself. But if the self is not in control of itself, what is in control of this self? Whatever is in control of this self, wouldn't it then be more fair to call whatever that is, that the self, since that is actually in power over this so-called self? Since these are external circumstances, for example, a lover who goes, or money that is lost, or bodily beauty that is lost, then these impersonal circumstances cannot be any self either, obviously, because they are something external from the process of being. So this is the argument of autonomy. A real self, a real identity, a real personality is in control of itself. It can control itself. I can also control myself partially, but it's a partial control. I cannot say, for example, I let this body not be sick and die. It's impossible. Let this mind not feel suffering. It's impossible. So these states I'm not in control of. This means that it is I. It's a mental construction. It's an idea. It's a label. It's a designation. But it's not a fact. It's not something real. And to relinquish that is release. It's to come out of the final prison. The ego prison, the ego tunnel. To come out of that tunnel, the Buddha said, is the highest bliss. Harmlessness is high bliss. Absence of sensual urge, of any kind of sense craving, is higher bliss. But the highest bliss is that, is this elimination of this abysmal conceit, this catastrophic and cosmic self-deception that I am, that there is an I, a self, a me, an ego that actually exists as a real and as an absolute. That's not the fact. It's only an idea. Unfortunately, it's the most self-destructive idea that the self could have of all ideas, because it promotes self-gratification. And this self-gratification is usually given first priority. This means that other beings then are wasted in this pleasure-seeking for themselves. And then, because the karmic echo effect of this evil doing in order to seek pleasure oneself, then one runs into suffering. So the ego process, or the conscious being of a stream of material and mental states, it goes against its own interest when it forms this idea of a self, a me, an I, an ego. And it's very tricky to escape, but it's possible. I think that's not for today, because my old dog, he's becoming impatient. So I guess we'll have to listen to him to be compassionate. Again, just to summarize, a central core concept of considerable value is the three universal characteristics, ti-lakkhana, also called the three signs, or the three absolutes. And they are: one, impermanence, anicca; two, suffering, dukkha; and three, no self. Let this be enough for today. Namo tasso bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Thanks for your attention, consideration and contribution, and have a nice day.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo tasso bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamitaya, will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.